Hello, I'm Graham Horton. Welcome to this new series aimed specifically at Panasonic Lumix Bridge camera users. Now, in this series, I'll be looking at all the buttons and controls of these cameras to give you a better insight as to how the camera captures your images. By understanding these features, it should enable you to apply that knowledge to capture better images. In today's video, I'd like to explain all about the camera lens markings and how you can use this information to make the right choices for your images. I've got two cameras here on the desktop, the very popular x60 zoom, the FZ8082, and the x24 zoom, FZ300-330. Let's first of all look at the FZ8082 and have a look at these specific lens markings. We've got the FZ8082 here, and we want to look specifically at the markings on the lens, which tells us all about its characteristics. You can see that there are two groups of numbers separated by an oblique. The numbers to the left-hand side of the oblique tell us the aperture range that the lens will operate in, and the right-hand side of the oblique tells us the focal length of the lens. Now, in this particular case, if you look at the letters to the left-hand side of the oblique, it says 1 to 2.8-5.9. So this lens has an aperture at its widest focal length, which is 20 millimeters in this case, of f2.8. But when we zoom it all the way in, which will be the x60 zoom position, that aperture will drop to f5.9. So we're losing effectively two stops of light when we go from the widest focal length setting of 20 millimeters all the way up to 1200 millimeters. So that gives us some problems in low level light shooting. The numbers to the right hand side of the oblique, 3.58 to 215, these are the native focal lengths of the lens. So it's 3.58 millimeters to 215 millimeters. Now I can hear you say, well, I thought this was a 20 millimeter to 1200 millimeters focal length lens. Well, let me explain a little bit about these markings and historically how they've been changed. When we first introduced digital cameras to replace film cameras, the original digital cameras had the same size of sensor as the film that they replaced, so they were full frame, but they were very, very low pixel counts, probably 1 to 2 megapixel. I can remember using the first DCS-1 camera from Kodak, and it had a 2 megapixel sensor, if I remember correctly. So when we had the first digital cameras, there was a direct conversion between using the film camera body and using the digital body. In fact, some of the first camera bodies, in fact, the Canon bodies, were in fact film camera bodies, and a sensor was placed at the film plane. So they were using the same lenses and same focal lens as we had with the film cameras. But as technology evolved, we managed to make these sensors much smaller to make much smaller compact cameras to compete with the smaller pocketable film cameras like the 126 and 110 cameras. And in fact, it's the disc camera that was out in 1992. So we had to make our sensors much smaller and to give more resolution, pack more pixels onto those sensor sites. But that meant that the lenses that were needed to give the same coverage on those sensors were much smaller focal lengths. So in the case of these 1/2-inch sensors, which you see in the FZ8082 and in the FZ300-330, these are 1/2-inch sensors with 12 or 18 megapixels on those sensors. The distance from the lens to the sensor is a much shorter distance, and therefore the amount of depth of field, that's the amount of acceptable sharpness from the front of the image to the back of the image, is much greater. Now, to allow us to explain the 3.58 to 215mm in a format that we can understand, there was an international format developed which we used what's called the crop factor. And the crop factor is really just the ratio of the diagonal of these sensors compared to the diagonal of 35mm film. And in the case of the 1/2-inch sensor, that turned out to be a factor of 5.5. So if we multiply the native focal length, in this case 3.58 millimeters by 5.5, we end up with our 20 millimeters equivalent focal length in terms of 35 millimeter full frame cameras. And again, if we multiply that 215 millimeters, which is the fully zoomed in position, multiply that by 5.5, and you arrive at that 1200 millimeters equivalent focal length. If we do the same maths on the FZ300-330, you can see on this lens, it says 1 to 2.8, but there's no dash to another lens aperture size. So what this is saying on this particular camera is that all the way from the native focal length of 4.5 millimeters to the longest focal length, which is 108 millimeters, the aperture remains at f2.8. So this becomes what's called a constant aperture lens. So again, if we use this 1/213 sensor diagonal equivalence, if we multiply our 4.5 by 5.5, we end up with 25 millimeters. And again, if we multiply the 108 millimeters by 5.5, we end up with our 600 millimeters equivalent focal length. So that should explain how we arrive at these effective or equivalent focal lengths from the native focal lengths. Now we also found that the crop factor worked effectively on the aperture to give us an equivalent aperture compared to 35mm full frame sensors. Now when we consider the equivalent focal length, we also compare the angle of view of the camera. So the angle of view is the angle subtended from the lens to the periphery of your image that's been projected onto the sensor. You can use what's called a field of view, but the field of view is a measurement of the width and the height at a specific distance from the camera. So that's more difficult to quantify. But if you use an angle of view, you know that you're at 55 degree angle of view, you've got something like a normal field of view as seen by your eyes. The aperture equivalence comes from the fact we can use the aperture of this camera multiplied by the crop factor to give us an equivalent aperture in terms of the depth of field achieved at the same focal length. So if I was to take the FZ8082 here at its widest focal length, which is 20 millimeters, and the aperture of f2.8, if I multiply that aperture by 5.5, which is indeed the crop factor, we end up with something like f11. So if I was to set a full frame camera to 20 millimeters, I would have to use f11 to give me the same depth of field on that camera as I'm getting with f2.8 on this smaller f2.8 aperture. Multiply that through the way all the way through, so you find that when you get to f8, multiply that by 5.5, you're looking at something like f64, which it gives us a tremendous amount of depth of field at that aperture. Now there's another factor that comes into play here called diffraction. I'm not going to go into that in this specific video, but it does mean that as you go to the smaller apertures, the light that bends around from those aperture blades gets dispersed a little bit and we lose a little bit of sharpness. So it's better to use these cameras at their widest aperture. So in the case of the FZ8082, better to use that f2.8 or f4 than using a 5.6 or f8. With the FZ300-330, because you've got that constant aperture lens, you can use f2.8 all the way through the focal range and you'll get some fantastic images, especially at the sweet spot, which is f4 on this particular lens. So we've seen how the native focal length can be transferred to give us an equivalent focal length in 35mm full frame terms, and we've now seen how the aperture equivalence can be multiplied to give us the equivalent depth of field given the same focal length of the lens on a full frame camera compared to that of the crop sensors camera. Now we also found that the crop factor can be used in a way to show us what the amount of noise would be on these sensors at a specific ISO. So in the case of the FZ80 or the FZ300, if we set the ISO to 100, On a full frame camera, we would find that if we multiply the crop factor squared by the ISO, we'll end up with something like 2500 ISO or 3200 ISO. And that gives us the same amount of noise as we get with the 100 on these smaller sensors, given we've got the same type of sensor, i.e. CMOS or MOS type sensor, in both your crop sensor and your full frame sensor camera. So that's how we can work out just how much noise will be available in our images at a specific ISO. And that's why I don't recommend that you use these cameras much beyond ISO 400 or 800, because you're then moving into the 12,800 or ISO 25,000, which is particularly noisy. So I hope those explanations help you to understand how to use the camera in a more general way, so you know how much depth of field you're going to get. So if you're a landscape shooter, you know you're going to get maximum depth of field, even f4, rather than using f8, which just takes you into that diffraction area, which gives you a softer image. In my next video, we're going to be looking at exposure and exposure compensation, how the camera works out what the right exposure should be, and some situations where the camera will get that exposure wrong because of the ratio of the brightness of your subject to the background or the background to your subject. So the camera will actually get things wrong, such as in snow scenes and beach scenes, and you'll have to make some manual adjustments so the camera gives you the correct exposure. And I'll explain how exposure compensation will allow you to do that. So if you're not a regular subscriber to the channel, why not hit that subscribe button and the bell notification icon, and you'll be advised now when I upload that next video in this series. So check out my photographic blog. I'll put a link to that in the video description below. You'll find a whole host of information on Panasonic Lumix Bridge cameras, ranging from the FZ200 all the way to the FZ2500. On my photographic blog, in the download section, you'll find lots more information and the application form to join my newsletter group. And that goes out to 4,000 people now, roughly between 4 and 6 weeks, depending on my health and just about the amount of time I've got to put that together. So that's it for this video. I hope you did find it useful. Give me a thumbs up if you did like it, and I hope to see you in the next one very, very soon. Goodbye for now.